Now, a next step, get out your bulletins. Today, we are finishing a series that we are calling Small Steps, Big Difference. I believe in my relationship with God, it hasn't been the big steps, the most challenging steps, that there wasn't any big incremental step in my relationship with God that was made the big difference. As I evaluate my life, and I've talked to many people, and I've listened to the stories, many of your stories, of how you've journeyed in your faith, I believe it's the small steps that have made the big difference in our relationship with God. And this series is not about small steps that's going to make a big difference in your weight, or small steps that are going to make a big difference in your health or in your career. This is about small steps that make a big difference in our relationship with God. And over the past 3 weeks, we've been looking at this series' big idea, write this in, that consistent small steps often make the big difference. That it's the consistent, the regular small steps, the regular steps that we take, those are the things that often make the big difference in our life. It's those small disciplines that make the big difference. In week one, we talked about the small step of directing our devotion to Jesus by first giving our money to him. When we first give to Jesus and his kingdom, it directs our hearts to Jesus and what he's about. And the second week, we talked about what is a small step that makes a big difference in our faith in God. We all want to be the big faith people. We all read the stories of people with big faith. How do we get to there? It's a small step. It's a small step of regularly, consistently engaging Scripture by reading it and applying it and prayerfully inviting Jesus into it. And then last week we talked about the small step of being in community, that we can't do life alone, that it's the regular, consistent engagement in a Jesus-centered community that leads us to the big difference we all want to see, that the fulfilling life that Jesus wants for me is found in community. We all want that big difference, and it comes from the small steps. And last week, we talked about how we have life groups, lifelines, life studies, and we have discipleship groups that are here to help you take that next step in community. And we've also challenged you that if you don't have to do one of ours, you can, if you've got a couple friends, you can get them together and say, hey, let's at least connect together on a weekly or biweekly basis and challenge each other to love Jesus, become like Jesus, and share Jesus together. And this week, I want to talk about a small step that makes a big difference, and probably one of the things that makes the biggest difference in our lives. And it will make the biggest difference, I believe, in your relationships. And that's our attitude. So I want to talk about our attitude today. And I believe that attitudes are important. I believe Jesus talked about attitudes a lot. Jesus addressed the attitudes of his disciples often. He might not have used it in the word as saying, hey, your attitude, you need a checkup from the neck up. That's what my mom used to say. Maybe your mom wasn't as creative as mine. But, you know, that was one of those things, hey, you need to look at your attitude. Or your attitude stinks. And Jesus, he didn't actually say your attitude stinks to his disciples, but he addressed their attitude a lot. He addressed the attitude of the Pharisees. And this is why I believe attitudes are so important. Write this in. See, our character is the result of our attitudes. Our attitudes are created, come, and they evolve out of our habits. And see, our character, it evolves into our habits. See, our attitudes create our actions, and the actions that we repeatedly do are the habits that we have, and that habit develops our character. And so out of our attitudes, our character, it grows and it morphs and it becomes who we are. And in our character, it's the things that we repeatedly do. And here's the thing, what I do and how I do it is so important. And that's comes from my attitude. Like for instance, my wife. I can do something from my wife, and what I do from my wife and how I do it from my wife is directly related to my attitude I have. Everybody knows that you can do something and have a bad attitude doing it, and you might as well not done it. Every parent in the room knows that. See, what I do and how I do it is formed from my attitude. What I do for the people that I work for and how I do it is directly the result of my attitude. What I do for the people that work for me and how I do it is a direct result of my attitude. But we need to step one step back. See, what is attitude? I believe attitude is a mindset. I believe our attitude is a pattern of thinking. And think about that, that your attitude is a pattern of your thoughts, that it's what you constantly think about. That's what shapes your attitude. See, write that in. Our thoughts then create our attitudes. It is our pattern of thought that evolves into our attitudes. And if Aristotle was as brilliant as we believe he is, he said, we are what we repeatedly do. And he makes it so simple. That's why he's so brilliant. And I would add to that, we're not just what we repeatedly do. We are what we repeatedly think. And I don't want to go Tony Robbins on you today. And I'm not here to give you a self-help talk and boost you at the beginning of the year on how you can change your mental capacity. But I do want us to think about what we think about. And I want us to think about our mindset. I want us to think about our attitude. Because, and I want us to step even one step further back. If our attitudes are made up of our thoughts, you know what your thoughts are made up of? What you believe. And as Christ followers, we believe that Jesus is God, and Jesus came into this broken world, and he gave up his life, and he died, and he was broken so that we could be restored into a relationship with God, and that he lives again, and because we trust in Jesus, his spirit is now alive inside of us. That is what we believe, and you know what that should do? That should shape how we think. That should shape how our attitude, our pattern of thought, the things that we repeatedly think that will change what we repeatedly do. And our response to what Jesus has done for us is that we would be on mission to love Jesus, become like Jesus, and share Jesus. But in order to become like Jesus, we need to own our part. We need to become like Jesus. But in order to become like Jesus, we need to understand today's big idea. And that's what I want to land on today, and everything's going to be formed around this. And by the end of today's teaching, I want to give you a practical way that you can be more like Jesus. But in order to be like Jesus, write this in your notes. If I want to be like Jesus, I need to think like Jesus. If I want to be more like Jesus, then I need to think a little more like Jesus. I need to share his mindset. I need to share the way he thinks. It's not just about imitating him, because everybody knows that you can imitate somebody, but if you don't think the way they do, that's where the power is. And I believe that when we begin to think a little more like Jesus, we'll be more like Jesus. And today I want to challenge you to think more like Jesus so you can be more like Jesus. Paul writes about Jesus' pattern of thought. He writes about his mindset to this church in Philippians, and in the second chapter, this is what he writes. He says, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. And I want to challenge you in this. Just pause button real quick. Because he says, in your relationships, you want to see if you want to see the big difference in your life, in your relationships, take this to heart. Have a change of mind. In your relationships, he says, with one another. And it could be with your spouse, that could be with your one another, it could be with your boss, it could be with your neighbor that you don't like. But in your relationships with one another, have the same pattern of thought. If we want to be a little more like Jesus, we need to think a little more like Jesus. And this is what Paul's saying to this church in Philippi, and I believe as we read it, it's almost like he's standing up here telling you, not me, telling you, that we need to think more like Jesus if we want to be more like Jesus. And this is what I would say to Paul. So Paul, how did Jesus think? And I believe Paul would say to us, this is how Jesus thought. Who, being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. This is what he said. He goes, this is what Jesus thought. See, Jesus knew he was equal with God. He was fully aware of all the power, all the authority, what that prestige meant. He knew what he had at his verbal spoken word that put everything into existence. He knew who he was. He knew he was equal with God. This was the very thing that John, the disciple John, would write about in John chapter 5 and said, hey, this is what got Jesus killed. See, he didn't get killed because he didn't think he was God. He got killed because he did think he was God. And for those that are trying to debunk what Jesus said about himself, see, Jesus declared that he was God. And that was the reason they wanted to kill him. And Paul says he knew who he was, but he didn't leverage who he was for his own preference. Write that in. See, Jesus didn't leverage his position to serve his preference. He didn't use it to his own advantage. He didn't use his creative power for his own comfort or his own popularity or his own prestige. He didn't use his position for his own profit. See, Jesus did something different. Yes, he knew who he was, but he leveraged all he was. And Jesus leveraged his position to write this, and so you can write this in, to serve people. That's what he did. See, Jesus would, as soon as he came to this earth, it wasn't about him. His very entrance into the world as a human was not in pomp and circumstance. That's the way I would have come. I mean, I would have come with the flashing lights, the big parade. I would wait till there's TV that could project it all over. But he doesn't do that. You know what he does? He says, it's about what I can leverage of my power for the people. In order to do this, I want you to know that it's not about me. And he comes in a very humble way into a manger. And the only light is a star that is revealed to those who are looking for it. And in this, see, Jesus doesn't leverage his position for his own profit and his own preference. He leverages it for people. That's what Jesus did. Jesus comes and the grand orchestrator of all things. And he comes and he enters this world. Not to turn the attention, to leverage it all for his own profit. But he turns it to leverage it to serve others. He doesn't come to be served. That's what I would have done. You know what, I would like, hey, you know what? You guys have screwed everything up. It's now for me to have my own. I want you to do this, I want you to do this, and if not, boom, you're done. But Jesus doesn't do that. He doesn't come to be served. He comes to serve people. Look what he says here. He tells his disciples in a moment that they need an attitude adjustment. They need that checkup from the neck up in this argument that they're having. He looks at them and he says this, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. I want you to hear what he says here. See, one, he identifies himself and gives himself a title that identifies him. In that day, they knew he was elevating himself as God, the Son of Man, because this spoke of the Deliverer, the Messiah, who God would then come to redeem his people and free his people. And when he said, he goes, that Son of Man didn't come up to serve himself. He didn't come up to serve, to be served, but to serve. See, he didn't come to be served, but he came to serve. And to be more like Jesus, I need to think a little more like Jesus. And this verse shows me that I have two choices, just like Jesus had two choices. Just like you have two choices. In every environment you walk into, you have two choices. In every room, in every relationship, in every phone call, in every encounter, in every meeting, in every opportunity you have, as a parent, as an administrator, as a boss, as an employee, as a neighbor, as a colleague, you have two choices, just like Jesus had two choices. I can be served or I can serve. See, I can be served and leverage everything for my own benefit, or I can choose to serve and leverage it for yours. See, I can choose to leverage it for me or I can choose to leverage it for you. And Jesus came not to be served, but to give, serve us. Matthew records what Jesus says when he says, and he gave his life as a ransom for many. See, that's what Jesus came to do in order to serve us. And the night before that epic moment happens, before he goes to the cross and he gives up his last breath in the ultimate act of sacrifice and the ultimate act of being a servant on mankind's behalf. The night before that, he has his disciples together for one last time. And this is what happens. See, he gets this meal together, and it was just before the Passover festival. And Jesus knew that the hour had come for him to leave this world, John records, and go back to the Father, and go back to his place, go back to where he had his position. And the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot. Judas already had this working out to betray Jesus. And Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. But because Jesus thinks differently, Jesus acts differently. And if we want to be a little more like Jesus, we need to think a little more like Jesus. We need to think not to be served, but we need to think to serve. And in this moment, we see how John records what Jesus does. And we're going to see what Jesus does because of what he thinks in a little bit later on. So this is what he says. So the evening meal was in progress. This was the Last Supper. This is what we commemorate, we remember, and we have remembrance of, and we recall in our elements of communion and the symbol that we have institutionalized in the church through the sacrament of communion. And the devil had already prompted Judas, the son of Simon Iscariot, to betray Jesus. Look what John says. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power. So Jesus knew what power he had and that he had come from God and was returning to God. See, Jesus knew who he was, all his power. He had it all under his control. He had it all there. But Jesus thinks differently. And if we're going to be more like Jesus, we need to think more like Jesus. And Jesus did something here that I think I would have done differently. See, I would have done something like this. The evening meal's in progress. I'm going to say, let's just make sure everything is in line. The setting's perfect. This is my last meal, guys. I want the steak. I want this. We're going to do it all in this alignment. It's going to be proper. It's going to be the memorable moment for all of us, and I want you to do it. But Jesus doesn't do that. See, there's something maybe that had not happened in the day. I don't know. We can't really read into it, and we can only imply that maybe something didn't happen, like somebody didn't call the servant to come and wash the disciples' feet or everybody that came into the room, because there was this protocol that whenever you came from a long day's journey into dinner, you know, like kids, we have to wash our hands. Well, back then they had to wash their feet because there was stuff on the road that you don't want it on your feet at dinner, and mama doesn't want it to stink. So they said, well, maybe that didn't happen around this time, and Jesus notices something. So this is what happens. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer garment. He took off his outer clothing and wrapped a towel around his waist. After that, he poured water into a basin and began to wash his disciples' feet. Resistance breaks out as he begins to, I believe, dry them with the towel that was wrapped around them. As Jesus goes from each disciple to another, this took time. You don't just clean mud that has been caked on for days really easily. It takes time. And Jesus, who knew who he was, had all the power and authority, he takes this place of a servant. He leverages his position to serve the people around him. He now positions himself as the least important person in the room. And as he gets around, he gets to Simon Peter. John records this, and he says, Simon Peter says, no, you're not going to wash my feet. See, you're the Messiah. You're the God. I realize you're God. In fact, I just had this revelation that you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that you are the Messiah. And on that, that's who you are. You are God. I've seen you calm storms. I've seen you with all the authority, and you, in just a word, everything on that lake just went calm. You have that authority. I've been mesmerized as you cause people to be healed. I've been blown away as people. I saw Lazarus come back to life, Jesus. You are God. You don't wash my feet. I wash yours. Because you're the more important person. And Jesus looks at Peter, and now that's not exactly how it reads. Those are my thoughts of what Peter was going through. But Jesus looks at Peter and says, you don't know, because you don't have any part of me unless I wash your feet. And he says something to Peter there. And Peter, in his very raw, he goes, well, then in that case, just wash it all. Come on now. And Jesus would go from disciple to disciple. He'd go to Bartholomew. He'd go to Andrew. He'd go to Thomas, who later would doubt him, doubt that he would ever come back to life, doubt that he was really God. And he would get to Judas. And he would look at Judas's feet. And a man who he knew had already made a plan to betray him, he would serve him. And he would wash his feet. When Jesus had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. Maybe John is referring to the place of the position that a teacher would have at the table, which would be like the head of the table. At that point, it might be in the middle of the table because of the way they sat. But he took his place, the place of prestige, the place of maybe power. I don't know if that's exactly what John says, but he indicates that he took his place. And then when he takes his place, he uses his place to declare something. And he looks at his disciples and he asks them a question. And I believe he would maybe lean in on the table after this awe-breaking moment. And he would look at them and say, do you understand what I've done for you? And I bet the disciples were speechless. And he says, do you understand what I have done for you? He says, you call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. He goes, yeah, this is who I am. This is what I am. I have that position. I have that power. I have that authority. That is what I am. But don't get caught up on what I am. I want you to get caught up on what I've done. And he goes, now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you should wash one another's feet. And then he says this, I have set an example. And I want you to circle that word example because that's very important in this. Because I have set an example that you should do as I have done for you. He goes, this is the example that you should do as I have done for you. That word example is a pattern. You know, it's not just like a one-time thing. See, this wasn't just one time that Jesus did it. This was a sum of Jesus' life. This was a pattern of his, that he would serve people, that he would become the servant and not leverage his authority for his own, but leverage his authority for the people. And he would take the place of a servant. He goes, this is the example. This is the pattern that I want you to follow. This is the example. This is the thing I want you to repeatedly do. You should do as I have done for you. You should do as I have done for you. And then he connects this. And before he connects it, let me get this real in our world, okay? The spouses, you should do what Jesus has done for you. You should do for your spouse what Jesus has done for you. Kids, teenagers, you wanna be more like Jesus? Think a little more like Jesus. Do for your parents what Jesus has done for you, not what your parents have done for you. Bosses, do for your employees, not what your previous boss has done, but what Jesus has done for you. See, let that be the pattern of thinking, because if we want to be a little more like Jesus, we got to think a little more like Jesus. Employers, employees, as you work for a company, hey, walk into that room and say, Jesus, how do I change my mentality? How do I do that I should do as you have done for me, for my neighbor? I should do as Jesus has done for me. For the person that has stabbed me in the back and betrayed me, I should do as you have done for me, because we've all sat in the seat as the betrayer. And Jesus says, for very truly I tell you, he gets to the belief side of this. Here's the truth of the matter. No servant is greater than his master, nor is a messenger greater than the one who sent him. And then he says this, now that you know these things, you will be blessed if you do them. What did Jesus think? He think that no service is greater than its master. And he, as the most important person in the room, modeled what it meant to have a mentality to serve. And if we follow Jesus, we believe that he is our example. He is the one that we pattern our life after. And if we pattern our life after him, then we need to think like Jesus did. And as we think more like Jesus, we'll be more like Jesus. And in this, he says, now that you know these things, you'll be blessed that you do. Now that you know, you'll be blessed that you do. See, you're not blessed that you know. You're only blessed when you do. You want your marriage to be blessed? You're not blessed if you know. You're blessed now if you do. You want your family to be blessed? You're not blessed if you know, you're blessed if you do. And I believe this is the blessing. This is what I believe it is. It's not that I know, it's that I know that I am made in the image of God. And that I'm made in the image of God, the blessing is that when I become more like Jesus by thinking like Jesus, by serving others, that I become more like Jesus, then I begin to fulfill my calling in life. That this is the most fulfilling place that I could be. That is the blessing. See, the blessing isn't in what I get out of it. The blessing is that I am fulfilling the purpose by which God created me, the purpose that you fulfill when God created you. See, your purpose is not to do something in a career. Your purpose is to be Jesus. That's what he created you to be. And you, if you want to be more like Jesus, you got to think a little more like Jesus. And Jesus said that if you want to follow my example, as I've done, you should do. And you're not blessed if you just know. You're blessed if you do. So write this in order to serve like Jesus. I have to think about others first. I've got to think about others first. In my mindset, like Paul said, I need to consider others. See, in order to serve like Jesus, I need to put others first. And this is what Jesus would say time and time again, that you, if you want to be first, you must be the last. To be first, you got to be the first to serve. What's the first thing you do when you walk into a room? What's the first thing you do when you walk home? What's the first thing you think of? What's your mentality? Because if we want to be more like Jesus, we got to change our mind and we got to begin to think a little more like Jesus. And what's the first thing that we do when we walk into a room? Is it all about our agenda? Is it all about serving and leveraging things for our comfort and our preference and our profit? Or how can we walk into a room and say, how can I leverage who I am and what I have to serve these people? And it doesn't matter the people. It doesn't matter what they've done to me. It doesn't matter what they can do for me. It's what Jesus has already done for me, because I should do as he has done for me. And I'm not blessed as I know. I'm blessed if I do. And in this, Jesus would look at a room and he'd walk in and I believe he would think differently. So to help you think differently, I just want to give you a question to ask yourself. Whenever you walk into any environment, maybe it's your environment when you walk home, Dad, or maybe, boss, it's when you get to that work and you're tired of that workplace and you wish you could go move on, but you can't. Or maybe it's that, maybe it's your neighborhood. I don't know what that environment is, but maybe it's at school or something that you have to go to every day. But whatever environment you're in that where people are around, you need to be a little more like Jesus. I challenge you to think a little more like Jesus. And ask this question, how can I help? How can I help? Just ask yourself that question, how can I help? I know I've got a meeting, I've got to run this meeting, but how can I leverage my power, my position to help these people? I know there's a bottom line that you can do, but if you ask that question, you take a different posture. You begin to filter things differently. Mom, dad, what would it look like for you? Man, spouses, try this at home. And don't just internally say this. Maybe you need to walk in, put your work stuff down, and I know it's been a long day, and you need to look at your spouse that's been there all day with the kids and say, hey, baby, how can I help? You might have to pick her off the floor and put her over here and say, hey, no, really, I said that. How can I help? How can I help? Bosses, what if you said this to your employees? How can I help you? Because if we want to be a little more like Jesus, we need to think a little more like Jesus. And one of the ways that I believe we can begin that process is we can just simply ask, how can I help? It's a small step that I believe will lead to a blessed and fulfilled life. And it's a small step that Jesus set in motion in the pattern that he put into place this evening. This evening when we celebrate, he took the bread and the elements of communion, and he initiates something that we as a church repeatedly do to remember. And I believe communion reminds us of two things. First, communion reminds us that Jesus is God and that he came to be broken. And just as we break the bread, and that bread is a symbol of the brokenness of Jesus' body, we remember that he was broken so we can be restored into a relationship with him. And that cup that we call juice, and back then they used wine, it represented the blood of a sacrifice. And Jesus said, this is a new covenant that I set up on my sacrifice, and this is a new covenant that I enter in with you. And I set this up, and this is the thing, is that it's only his blood that can cover all my sins. It's only his blood that cannot just cover all my sins, but it's only his blood that can cover everybody's sins. See, it only could be God who comes in the form of a man to live the sinless life that I can't live, to become the sacrifice for me. Yes, I remember, and that makes me grateful. So when I remember communion, it's out of gratitude for what Jesus has done. But secondly, it reminds me of what I should do. You should do as I have done. You're not blessed if you just know. You're blessed if you do. And this is the pattern that Jesus puts in place that we remember today. And we're going to take communion today. And if you're new with us, we believe in open communion, meaning that you don't have to be a member of our church to do so. If this is your next step today, to remember what Jesus has done for you, or you're wanting to walk into a relationship with Jesus today, I want to invite you to take communion with us, remembering that Jesus' body and his blood is what brings us into a relationship with him as we trust in him. But today I want to do it a little differently. You may be sitting with somebody that you need to serve today. And this is maybe what you need to do. Maybe you need to walk up here with them and you need to say, hey, will you just stand here? And it's going to take a lot of time. We got 12 more minutes in the service. We're going to take the time. The band's going to sing, and we're going to just take our time in this moment. And when you get to this moment, maybe you need to just have them stand there. You need to get the elements and you need to give it to them. And you need to begin to pattern your mind. And we need to begin to do what Jesus has done. Maybe that person you need to serve is not in this room. Maybe they're outside of this room. But you need to come forward and you need to take this. And you need to take this and say, Jesus, I remember what you've done. And God, this is what I need to do. I need to serve. Maybe that person is on the other side of the room, in this room. And you need to go grab them and say, can I serve you communion? And as the band plays, at any moment you feel led to come and participate in communion, I pray you do it reminding yourself what Jesus has done, and also reminding yourself what we should do. Because if we're going to become more like Jesus, we need to think more like Jesus. And at any time today, you will take the communion elements on your own. You will not be led. So I encourage you to do that. And maybe you need to do that together as a family. Maybe you can do that together as a neighbor. But who do you need to serve communion to today? I want to read what Paul writes. He says, For I received from the Lord what I also passed to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is broken, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whenever you're ready, as a band plays, will you come and remember what Jesus has done? And remember what we should do? And if you need to bring the people that you're serving, just say, hey, I want to serve you today. And you can serve them those elements. And then you can take those elements on your own whenever you feel led to, thinking about his body broken for you and his blood that makes us right with him. And I'll come back and close.